Hey Tasmania, get crazy because the Rewind 80s mixtape tour is coming to your area of planet Earth. Saturday, April 6th, Launceston Theatre North. Sunday, April 7th, Hobart Theatre Royal. We'll see you there. And Melbourne, you can also get ready to dance because we're at the Hallam Hotel the 2nd of March 2024. Tickets are all selling fast. Get your tickets on rewind80sband.com. Episode tonight,
very
all the way
special.
From New Zealand.
Sammy's on tour.
I know. So surreal. So many stories to tell.
I bet there is.
You know? How's your week been?
Not too bad. I've started my new job. It's going really well. To be honest, I can't stop thinking about you and all the fun you'd be having. But, you know, a large part of me would rather be on tour.
Look, mate, I had the guilts yesterday. It's a big thing, you know, like you know, I just saw Jim Kerr in the fucking reception, you know, just on his own, and we had a chat. And you're hanging out with all these amazing artists that you do – because it's my first sort of big one, you do feel a little bit guilty about leaving everyone behind. You know what I mean?
I had
a bit of a meltdown yesterday, and Maddie just had to get me a champagne because I was like, oh, I feel like I'm not sharing it, you know. And Maddie's like, well, and then the boys are like, oh, we've got imposter syndrome. And I'm like, what the fuck's that? It's kind of the same thing where you think, what the fuck am I doing here, you know?
Yeah. Look, we've got a really exciting show coming up, guys. We've got some very special guests that we're going to be interviewing very soon. But first of all, I'm Jay Jovi.
I'm Sammy HardOn.
Welcome to the 80s Montage, folks.
Yes, welcome.
This week's episode is a bit sort of bit generous. Basically, it's going to be favourite 80s tracks of the rock stars. And you'll see what we mean a little later.
When we
chat to our guests. But in a nutshell, Sammy is away on tour in New Zealand at the moment, and she's with none other than Pseudo Echo, her band, Sammy and Maddie's band, led by our very good friend Brian Canham. And on the bill as well is Simple Minds, Texas, and Collective Soul. Collective Soul are actually a 90s band, but they've got sort of massive 80s connections as well. So we're going to talk about that very, very soon, folks.
Yeah.
So very, very exciting.
And that's right. And Collective Soul were the first guys we really resonated with when we were in the tents backstage, which kind of thought might happen. I wasn't too sure whether we'd get straight in with Texas or Simple Minds, but the girls from Simple Minds are fantastic. Everyone in the team is fantastic, but they went on later than us. So Collective Soul were on after us. So we were the ones that sort of generated together at the start. And from that moment, we were inseparable. We were just like, You guys are great. And the big thing at the moment with Pseudo Echo is Abby being 20 years of age and such an incredible drummer. And she's so gorgeous because she did a big drum solo on the first gig we had in Auckland or Hamilton, one of the two. And she did a drum solo and just started crying on stage.
Oh, wow.
And I was like, oh, my God, she's 20, you know?
Yeah, yeah, how brilliant.
So we've been sort of looking after her and taking her into town and the boys just love her because she's 20, you know what I mean?
Yeah,
and
yeah, exactly
right. It is incredible
right.
that watching a young girl, obviously 30 years, you know, younger than I am, dealing with this so well. Like there was one stage in Pseudo where the track just stopped and she turned it on again without a glitch and we all couldn't fucking believe it. Like Cannon was like, oh, my God, Abby, that is just so good, you know. So it's been really interesting.
Did she just sort of turn the PowerPoint on or something obvious like that?
No, she just had to find – she just had to take it back on the marker, which was – it's like when you read music on a computer, you know, like Pro Tools and stuff. So
I know what you mean. You got to sort of find
like
your –
something like that. Like that a 20-year-old might have just lost their mind over,
yeah,
you know.
Yeah, yeah.
And so that was really good. And then another – I mean, I can only remember things in pictures. I've been taking heaps of films and stuff. Charlie from Simple Minds, who is the guitarist, has all of a sudden become infatuated with Pseudo Echo and listening to all the records and actually came up to Brian and said and commended him for all his body of work and stuff. So Brian just couldn't believe it, you know.
Yeah.
Because Paul Bry, even though he's an Australian icon, he does cop it a bit with a lot of artists, jealousy and all that stuff, and he's had a shit manager for a long time that sort of told him he wasn't that good anymore, you know. And and we've all had that. And now all of a sudden it's a whole new thing because it's sort of like family running the band, you know.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah,
and he was
fantastic.
Just in shock. So things like that, the gigs have been going great. It did rain in Hamilton. So
all right, well, so where did you guys land?
Let's start at the beginning. Maddie here to help me because I can't remember everything. So we landed in New Zealand. What was the first landing? Yeah, Auckland we landed and then we went to a thing called Taipo?
Oh, yeah, Taipo, Lake Taipo, yeah?
Yeah, Taipo.
Sorry, folks.
I don't even think it's pronounced like that. It's they pronounce it knee tapo or something, tapo. I can't even remember. So we landed there and then we did sound check the next day.
Yep.
Which was around ours got moved to about 4 o'clock. Anyway, so we had a sound check and that was all really, really good. And we then basically got fed. Went back to the hotel and then we had to get on at 12:30 in the afternoon.
Mm.
So it was like a early afternoon gig, which is hard because you think, is anyone going to be there and blah, blah, blah. And it was packed. There were thousands of people there.
Wow, how fantastic.
And we started our show. We went a little bit long, so we had to shorten the show a bit, but it's really rude to do that, you know, when you've got other bands after you. So that'll happen. But they did the same thing as well. They were like, oh, my God, it's so easy to do where you can go over too much.
Yeah.
And it went over really well. Of course, Funky Town being the big one in New Zealand, and I think a Beat For You is big in New Zealand as well, that charted. So the other stuff they just went with. But, of course, a lot of those people would have bought the records, you know.
Yeah, yeah. Brilliant.
Yeah, so it's been really interesting. You're kind of playing with the big boys, you know?
Absolutely, yeah. Mm. Now, was there any sort of official meeting of all the bands or did you just sort of find yourselves backstage at the gig and it was quite informal, like meeting each other and so forth?
You kind of – oh, I can't even remember – I don't think we had an official meeting of the bands.
Yeah, so right.
The Simple Minds girls watched half of our set the first. Everyone watched each other the first gig because there was an outside area. The second gig, it rained and it wasn't undercover. So you really couldn't hang out and watch the other bands unless you're on the stage, and there's just too many people on the stage. So we watched all the bands, and Simple Minds obviously were last on and they were incredible. Jim Kerr does all the stuff he did when he was in the 80s. Like he's the toe tap and the whole lean with the leg stretch, and he leans right back and touches his head on the ground. Like he's pretty bloody fit, you know?
Yeah, yeah.
That's amazing. And then we spoke to him after the gig, and he was speaking to Brian, and he said, you know, I can't understand the accent at all. But he said, if I came to see me, I would want to see all those that stuff I did in the 80s.
Yeah, you know what I mean? Yeah, right. Yeah, that's fantastic that he realizes that. You know what I mean? I love it when artists sort of have a good sense of what their audience want to see, and they're really mindful about paying respect to that expectation rather than getting all funny about it and running from it. You know what I mean?
Well, what he does though is he gets on his knees and then bends over backwards and touches his head. It's like a yoga position. And you kind of think to yourself, wow, did he do ballet as a kid? And he gets asked that a lot.
Yeah.
But he's still got the essence of the cat moves and the whole looking through you kind of vibe. He very much is like that all the time. You know?
Yeah, yeah, fantastic. So Jim is from Glasgow, isn't he? He's Scottish, isn't he?
Yeah, that's right. And so are Texas.
They are. I forgot about that. Yeah,
so there's
right.
a whole lot of Scottish flags in the audience.
Yeah, fantastic.
And it's just incredible.
Well, there is actually like a large, quite a large Scottish population in New Zealand, I believe. There's actually sort of areas down south on the South Island where they were predominantly Scottish colonies, and so the accents, you can hear the sort of Scottish influences in their accent from those particular cities and towns.
100%, because the New Zealanders have no problem in understanding the Scottish accent. Where Aussies just don't know where we are, you know. And I'm pretty I'm pretty sure Jim said to me today something about singing, and I completely missed it. And then when I went home, I went, I think he did say singer. I can't remember, but such gorgeous guys. Charlie, you can understand the guitarist a little bit better.
Yeah,
but it's an amazing accent, you know.
Yeah, beautiful. Yeah.
I haven't met Charlene from Texas. I'm a bit starstruck by her. She's a very powerful force, the old Charlene.
Gotcha. I was talking to one of my colleagues at work today, and she's actually a muso as well.
Yeah.
And in bands and so forth. Yeah. And lovely lady called Kirsty. She's probably listening. I was telling her about the podcast today, and I sort of went through the list of bands, and when I said Texas, she nearly sort of jumped off her seat.
Yeah.
Because she said, I am a massive fan. She said, like, I love, like, even all the album songs and the B-sides and everything. And I was like, wow, isn't that incredible that, like, Texas isn't, you know, you wouldn't think out of all the bands that you could choose from that the person sitting next to you, that's going to be their favorite band. So, you know, it was a real surprise. She was absolutely pumped and excited. So, that's
right. And they're the ones going down, I guess, the best, you know?
Yeah, right, because they're a surprise.
It's really interesting. Like the media are loving Texas. They've got a female drummer as well, and they also have – oh, two guitarists and a bass and keyboards and stuff. But, yeah, she's a real giver, you know. Like she just knows how to get a crowd excited. They started with their hit song, Babe. So she comes out and goes, I don't want a lover. And you're like, fuck, that's pretty brave to come out to your biggest hit straight up.
Yeah, yeah.
But like everything else, when you hear all the songs, you go, oh, I remember that, I remember that, Black Eyed Boy,
exactly right.
I remember that.
Yeah.
And everyone's loving her and Texas. And Pseudo are getting a really good rap as well. We're getting fantastic reviews.
Yeah, yeah. Brilliant. So what has been your favourite sort of stage or venue that you've played so far?
Oh, Tarpo was great. That was amazing because we had – it was hot and it was warm and we had tents to hang out with everyone.
Yep.
Because we've all got drivers and we're being driven around wherever we want, and if you want this, they go and get it for you and stuff.
Brilliant.
But we could also watch the show side of stage.
Fantastic.
Which we did, you know.
Yeah, yeah.
And I went out front for Collective Soul to video their stuff just to show people how many people were there. And that's the other thing. I've been hanging out with Ed, who's the lead singer.
Yeah,
he's fantastic, and he just so friendly, and his wife was here. She's just recently left to go back. But really lovely family, and they're like, come into our tent, come in, you know. It's really unusual. They're really, really good. And these guys do 70 gigs a year still, you know.
Yeah, right. Wow, that's amazing.
And they've got 74,000 people on their Facebook, right?
Yeah,
like that's a lot of people.
Gotcha, yeah. Look, they were huge sort of in the 90s. When I was in high school, I mean, a lot of their songs were like the soundtrack of my teen years, you know?
Yeah,
I think it was Shine. I remember Shine playing on the radio when I broke up with my girlfriend at the time.
Right.
Yeah, I remember it playing in the background, and it was just sort of heartbreaking. You know, those moments where you hear a song and it just transports you back in time to a certain moment. That was sort of what I'm talking about. Every time I hear Shine, I go back sort of to 17 years old, you know, breaking up with my high school sweetheart, so I thought. Yeah.
You don't realize how big that song was until you do look at your life, because I was the same. I said to Ed, I was in Ellie Beach this time that single came out, and the punters wanted it. We had a duo, you know, it was my ex-boyfriend and myself, and they're like, play Shine, Collective Soul, and they're really giving us a hard time. We had to go and program it on drums and bass and put it on an MC500 to do the song, and George just sang it on guitar and played. And it sounded amazing. And he said, well, that's all I used in the studio. He said it was a backyard demo, Sammy.
Yeah.
So exactly what you did was what it was. And it just
got
sent out.
It was a big surprise hit. Yeah. It was a massive surprise for everybody. And it just sort of shot them, you know, like it says online, from obscurity to popularity. Like no one knew them, and then all of a sudden everyone knew them. Yeah, how incredible.
Yeah. And you do remember exactly where you were when it was released. So I agree with that, because I remember thinking, I'm going to get killed if I don't play this song.
There was an incredible sort of sound that was very popular in that mid-90s period, sort of when they shot up. And it's sort of, I guess, a post-grunge sound. You know, you had your big wave at the very end of the 80s and the early 90s of sort of pure grunge band. Nobody knew at the time what to call them. And then the sound sort of, I guess, softened and developed a little bit, and you had like all these amazing bands come out on the other side, and Collective Soul being one of them. They refer to it as sort of post-grunge. I wouldn't say sort of Collective Soul are a grunge band at all, but
And there's so many members in the band. There's like 6 or 7 members. They're a big band.
Yeah. Yeah.
And they're all still well manicured, and Ed comes out there like in a pink jacket and a hat and stuff, but still demands the audience. Like they're still in, I think those songs have really stood the test of time live, you know, because even the ballad I hadn't heard for many years, and I went, oh, this song's fucking great. And then when they sang it live, it really just a good song. And I think Ed just wanted to be a songwriter at the end of the day. And then the radio stations got hold of Shine, and it just, you know, did that exact thing.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Now, another sort of fantastic point about Collective Soul is that they've got a lot of their original members, haven't they? So you've got sort of Ed and Dean, who are brothers, and then Will, who's the bass player. And so you've got sort of most of that front line there sort of still from back in the day.
Yeah, that's right. That's so brilliant. Yeah, but the drummer is Johnny Rab, and he is the new. He's been the drummer for over 10 years, maybe, but we'll find out soon. And then Cheney is the tour manager now, and he used to be the drummer. So this is the interesting thing. They've kept it in the family, and they now tour. And it's a big everyone has their own monitor. They have their own lights. They have their own front of house. And bring their wives along. Like, this is where people just don't spare any thought to how much money's been spent. You just get the gig and that's it, you know. Australia's not good at that. I've noticed we're not good at that. We really like to, oh, we'll just take this and just take that. There's no – they're kind of bigger thinkers, I think, in America.
Yeah, right. Yeah.
I just feel like we're always hit around the head. You're not really that good all the time. And I think that's what's – challenging for me, because Pseudo Echo was that size in this country, you know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah.
And it's just interesting how you can be perceived and how you perceive yourself and how scary that thought is, you know?
Yeah, yeah, brilliant. So apart from gigging, what have you guys been getting up to in terms of
today? Today we went to the Jets. The Jets. Oh, they're on the phone now. So we may as well bust the idea. We've got two guys from Collective Soul coming on the show today. So excited. And they're just on the phone to Maddie, and we're going to let them in the room. So they're in our hotel room, and they're going to be – we're going to have a chat to them about the industry.
Beautiful. Very excited to speak to them, guys.
Yes.
We'll sort of take you through who we've got in the room as they enter. So they're coming up from the lobby. How exciting.
Well, let's see what happens. Maddie's on the phone. But I was going to say we went to the jet boats, you know, the boats who go around the cliffs and stuff.
I saw a bit of footage of that. How did that go? How did you go with that?
Do you know what? I didn't want to do it. And the boys were like, well, we need seven members and you're the seventh. And then we took the driver. Because I didn't want to go on, and then I went, well, I'm not going to die. They obviously know what they're doing. So I went on and I loved it. I loved it. Oh, I thought fantastic. The spinning around in the water was the easiest part.
Yeah, right, right. They go very close to the sort of to the rocks, don't they?
They do. Look, I was going to shut my eyes when we did the big spin around, and then I thought I'll probably be sick. So and I'll probably panic. So I just kept my eyes open and it was fine. But I was mini shitting myself. I'm not good at that stuff.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And I had Abby next to me.
So you had Abby, you had Maddie and Mud. And who else?
The guitar tech Scotty.
Yep.
So he was the one really, you know, come on, Sammy, you've got to come on and it'll change your life. And I'm like, oh, I don't know if it'll change my life. But it was pretty – the scenery in New Zealand is just – where did you tour in New Zealand with 10,000?
Very similar route to what you guys are doing, in fact. So sort of starting in Auckland and then going south. We were sponsored amongst our sponsors, Winnebago actually partially sponsored our tour, and we had this amazing, incredible big camper that we picked up in Auckland and then drove. And we sort of part of the deal was that we sort of document our tour and you know, showed off how much fun we were having, and oh my God, it was just incredible. We did sort of you know, we did bars, we did clubs, we did bigger stages, but we also did fun things like going and doing acoustic sets at wineries and stuff like that.
Yeah,
where
right.
It'd just be sort of different groupings of, you know, two or maybe three of us getting up, and you know, those ones you can do a little bit drunk, so it was fine. You know, you'd do a little wine tour and then you'd sort of get up and do your set, which was a lot of fun. But we slept in the Winnebago in this massive big vehicle and got the ferry down to the South Island and then did all the South Island and we really couldn't have picked our favorite bit. You know, really couldn't have picked what was the most amazing thing.
Yeah, no, I think tomorrow, I think Saturday is going to be one of my favourite shows. The stage looks amazing.
And where are you playing on Saturday?
We are in Queenstown, which is just out of this world. Like the view out of our apartment is just mountains, like a photograph, you know.
Queenstown is incredible.
Oh, yeah. Unbelievable. And we just went and had a pie by the lake today and the ducks were there and just stuff like that you just love, you know.
Brilliant. So you've had a good sort of measure of both gigs and downtime, yeah?
Yeah, so we've only done two gigs but they were fantastic and then we've had 4 days downtime.
Beautiful.
And just getting to look at the country. So it's been a little bit of a holiday, you
know? Yeah, yeah.
Which That's Raquel brilliant. Really needed. The you know manager wifey needed a really big holiday because it's just been so full on.
Yeah,
the like saying you know we did the boats for free today. You know the big jet boats. Didn't pay for that. Yeah, so we were organised as long as we promote Pseudo Echo on the boats and blah blah blah. And Brian didn't end up going in the end. And we're like, well, you can't tell anyone when you're wet and you're bloody, your hair's blowing in your face anyway.
Yeah,
so we went down there and they were as happy to have us, you know, which is great. Let's play some music and I'll find out what's happening with the boys.
With the boys.
And we'll be back soon, guys. You're listening to the 80s Montage. Echo, a beat for you. So the boys are 10 minutes away.
Brilliant.
Yeah, so that'll be fun. And we're going to be talking to a couple of the Collective Soul boys and it's going to be fantastic because they're really good storytellers and they've done so much in the industry. A lot of drummers are going to love this show.
Yeah, we've got a couple of drummers basically.
That's it, like world class drummers, which is awesome. And so what else can I tell you? So it's weird because you just bump into everyone at reception or just in the hallway or stuff like that or what are you doing for dinner? Do you want to come out for dinner? Like, you know, the boys were like, do you want to go out for dinner? And I'm like, no, I really want you to come over to our apartment and do a podcast. And they're like, yeah, that's great. You know, we'll come over then. So
bit of everything.
Yeah, no, they're just really lovely guys. Johnny Rapp has his own 80s band as well. So I have he wants to talk to us about that. I haven't heard much about it, but Mud has spoken to him about it. So that's it's great. Really interesting. But yeah. Look, we are having a ball here. It's gone too quick.
Yeah, yeah. And when do you come home?
Sunday.
Okay.
Yeah.
So big gig on Saturday and then on the plane the next day.
Yeah, so the gig's at 12:30 in the afternoon mm-hmm. and then we'll probably spend the whole day with the other bands.
Yeah, yeah.
And then maybe they will have a dinner that night. I'm not sure. I think Cheney was going to do that, organise that. He's very good with all that stuff, like knows yeah. how to really good talker, really good people person. I couldn't tell you what part of America, even though they've told me a million times where they're from in America, you can ask them all that anyway, but just really lovely guy, like, and they'll buy you drinks and stuff. So there's, it's just, I just find it amazing that Collective Soul are still, you know, really big overseas. We don't hear that stuff in Australia, you know.
They have a beautiful sort of it's what I refer to as a sort of middle American sound, where it's like it spans across the decade and it really fits in with those big sort of, I guess, like Midwestern bands like Creedence Clearwater Revival. You might say the Eagles. You might say Lynyrd Skynyrd and stuff like that. You know what I mean? Mm. Like those, they remind me of that kind of like really salt of the earth, grainy sounding, edgy sounding band. You know what I mean? And I think that's why they've lasted so long, is they've got that beautiful timeless quality.
Another thing, they're so professional and lovely. And I think that's a big part of it, you know.
Yeah.
Like just being friendly and still loving what you do.
Yeah, yeah.
You know. Very hard to find that in bands that are friendly and they yep. get a bit up on their high horse and a bit egotistical. There's none of that here. You know, it's interesting. It's a really different level. And I can tell you now, and you would know this, the one thing I have learned about myself is it's a lot harder being in an original band than it is a cover band.
Oh, gotcha.
Like you just have to have more – I don't know, you've just got to have your wits about you and just, I don't know what it is. It's just a bigger game, you know?
Yeah, yeah.
So you can't be a wanker, you can't be a dickhead, you can't be a swearer, you can't be this. I mean, you know, these boys. Well, yeah,
reputation is absolutely everything.
These boys really don't know what they're coming into with us, but we'll get them on anyway. So, look, eventually we'll get them in and we'll talk about their favourite 80s stuff. But, yeah, we did come up with that segment, famous people and what they loved in the 80s, because these boys will be fantastic because they're 50. They're around 50. I think Cheney is 50 and Johnny is 52, same yeah, age. Right. And really lovely. And there's no huge parties and stuff like that. Like everyone's older and just hanging out and resting and going to see New Zealand, you know.
Well, they want a career and they're centered, you know, so that's awesome. Hey, just as the boys are preparing to walk in, can I just ask, I've got to ask for my friend Kirsty.
Yeah.
Have describe sort of Charlene and what she's like in person from Texas.
Oh, okay. So Charlene, for me, has this aura about her before you even go near her. She wears no makeup. She has the same jet black hair. She wears a tracksuit on stage, almost like a pants and a top. She really is not what you expect. Like she's just like a chick that comes out, I don't know, and she's just an amazing singer. Like her voice is spectacular.
Yeah.
But there's no big makeup or big – I don't know what it is. There's this aura about her that's bigger than her, you know?
Yeah, yeah.
And when she sings so fucking beautifully and her pitch is perfect. She plays guitar perfect. And she reminded me of, and I know this is going to be, this is going to sound stupid, her female Michael Jackson.
Oh, wow. Serious?
It was just bizarre because she demanded the, the stage and the audience. The audience love her, you know. I think it is because she's so natural and stuff like that. Yeah. But what we might do, babe, is stop the show and then fix the boys up and have a quick chat amongst us and then start the interview. What do you reckon?
Beautiful. Sounds good.
Gentlemen, you're listening to the 80s Montage. I'm Sammy HardOn and we've got the most amazing guests on the show tonight. Collective Soul, Johnny and Cheney, who were air drumming while we were playing this song, by the way. It was like a drummer's paradise in this little hotel room.
That's right. Yes.
Who doesn't dig that song?
Oh, exactly. You know what? That's been the highlight of me, for me, this whole tour.
Great, great, great. We love that song.
It still gives me butterflies in my stomach. Mm. It just blows me away. For me, I was sort of in my late teens as this was coming out, and I said to Sammy before, each and every song just takes me back to that time so strongly.
Great. Are you going to – now, we want to get over towards you. I'm now the tour manager of the band, and Johnny's the drummer of the band. And, you know, I used to play drums for the band in between the years of 2008 and 2012, and then I played with a few other groups, which we'll talk about in a little bit. But Johnny came in 2012 and has been an absolute perfect match for this group. I mean, he can play any of the stuff, and he has some of the best drum parts I've ever heard. Ever.
And that's a really interesting transition for you, Cheney, sort of moving from drummer to like more of a management position. Was that a sort of – did you get into sort of tour managing straight away with the band, or was it after like a bit of a hiatus and you came back? Can you talk us through that?
Sure. So in 2012, I decided to do some other stuff musically, and, you know – it's tough leaving something that you love so much, but it was time. You know, sometimes you're like, okay, it's time to do this. So I did, and I played with a lot of great people over the years that I was away from, you know, everyone. And, you know, oddly enough, I started playing with a music group called Like Machines out of Atlanta, Georgia, and they were still, you know, in cahoots and friends with all the guys in the band. So it was kind of like a reintroduction, and it was like we never were away from each other. So it was really nice. And then, you know, after time passed, you know, Ed and I were hanging out a good bit before, and then we were hanging out, you know, during probably around 2017 is when we started hanging out again, which was really awesome. I really missed him and the guys. And then he, you know, finally asked me in 2020 or 2019, he's like, would you like to be the tour manager of the band? I'm like, well, okay, I could try it. You know, I feel like I could do a decent job, but you know, it's all a learning process. Any of this is a learning process. Gotcha. So it came pretty naturally, and I've learned, you know, I guess it was a good fit because I knew the guys and I knew what they wanted and what they needed. And that's really what my job is, to make sure they get everything that they want and need, and that they get from point A to point B and safely and comfortably and all that type of stuff. And, you know, the best part about this whole transition was me having my newly, well, it's not new anymore, but Johnny Rab and I are like best friends, and we respect one another as musicians and as just as buddies. And that's been the best thing about this, you know. So,
yeah, buddy.
Yeah.
Amazing.
That's fantastic.
So Johnny, what were the bands you had done before you joined Collective Soul?
I was strangely in Nashville, Tennessee from 1996 to 2009. Mm. And Cheney's and my path, our paths have crossed many times from Atlanta to
Nashville. Isn't that always the way?
Yeah. From Atlanta to Nashville, similar friends, similar musicians, the drum industry. And I always had, I think we both had it, the respect for each other and all the past drummers of Collective Soul. And it's not a joke. Like, we are super tight friends. And like, even despite some of the internet can do some funky things where they try to pretend.
Yeah,
you guys, really? Yeah, you must hate each other.
Yeah, isn't it unbelievable?
How is Johnny Rab going to do this gig?
Yeah, right.
And like, is Cheney mad at Johnny? Johnny hates Cheney.
Yeah, yeah.
So Cheney's laughing right now. But in all seriousness, the respect I have for him, we will work on parts together. We're doing the latest records at the same time, in the same place. So it's more than tour managing. It is like a team.
It is. Yeah.
Even friendship wise, we just hang. Cheney's studio knowledge is massive. So he's helped me with my studio at home.
Right.
Gear, how to understand different things I don't understand, because I'm just a drummer. I may have done a few, I guess, like assistant engineering, but that'd be like more cable wrapping and being like, this is an XLR, rather than understanding microphones. But anyway. Mm. You asked about the other bands. I was from California, and I was trying to do the Nashville country pop drummer thing for years. Did it, but it got very frustrating because in those bands, unlike Collective Soul, it didn't feel like a band. It was like the artist, and then
the backing band.
Totally.
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Yep.
And you could get let go and I got hired and refired. Refired, you like that? I mean, that's a new term.
Hired and refired. Drummers do, though. For some reason, drummers go back. You know, they're like boomerangs, you know? Exactly. It's like, getting back, we're fighting. I've fired one drummer 4 times. They're really good people, but sometimes fucking it could be the click or the freaking stick up their ass. They don't know what they're doing, right? And you fire them and you go, oh, he was all right, wasn't he, that guy?
I mean, I even made up a new term, refired, not rehired. Because I was refired. I was hired, fired, rehired, and then refired.
Yeah.
And that was Tanya Tucker. And she still is very, very
Tanya
cool.
Tanya Tucker.
Yeah. And that was a challenging gig. Yeah.
Mm.
Fun gig.
And you're really easy to get along with. So I can't believe that. Because you asked me at dinner the other night about Brian Canham in Pseudo Echo and if he allows us to do whatever we want.
Right.
And I said, oh, yeah, he's just... you do whatever you want on stage. I said, with the dancing, I sort of tested it a bit and went more and more, and then he went, oh, no, do the front woman thing, you know. And he's always great to let everyone run their own thing on stage.
Which I think is amazing. It's a great show, energetic.
You would get that with Collective Soul, though, yeah?
I mean, it's gotten to a point where I don't go up and, you know, dance.
No, not you.
But...
Well, I bet you do.
No, but in all truthfulness, I guess.
Yeah.
I've told Cheney before some of the records that he's on with Collective Soul. I'm like, love that song and that part for real.
Yeah.
And so there's a weird thing with the band that we all can go, oh my God, Ryan Hoyle killed it on this record, or Shane slayed it. Yeah. Yes. Or Cheney. And just real quick, there's freedom to play, and I feel like it's a good fit with the band on stage. We all have a good time. It's more comfortable than any of the country things. It really would be for no reason. The Taney Tucker would be because a friend of mine, Jack Gavin, who was a Charlie Daniels original drummer, wanted the gig back. Okay, Johnny.
Oh, really?
Yeah, and it's okay.
Yeah, that's right.
Kind of sucks human balls, but it was... Yeah.
That's great. Awesome. But isn't it funny how... You're in Collective Soul. You've been in that for how long now?
I think this is going on like the 12th year or something like that.
The 12th year, right?
Yeah.
And you're 20 maybe? Even more?
As far as...
he is 20.
I'm
20
years old.
He looks 20. He looks fabulous.
Oh, thank you. Thank you.
You look like you do in the photos.
Oh, God. Well...
Yeah, both of you do though.
Oh, you're so sweet. Thank you.
Listen to how humble they are. You can't help but love them, Sammy.
They're so humble.
And I've got to say, guys, your accents are so beautiful to the Australian ear. They really are.
Yeah. Well, so are your, you.
Really?
The feeling's mutual, my friend.
Wow.
Oh, that's great. Where exactly are you from?
I'm more southern than Johnny. Johnny grew up in California a good part of his life. I grew up in Georgia. Yeah. So we're going to have people have walked up to Ed and I and said, are y'all from Australia?
Oh, is that right?
Really?
Well, no, we're not. We're not from Australia. No,
isn't that interesting?
No, but it's great. We love your accent as well. And we love brilliant. Outback Steakhouse, so then there's that.
Yeah.
Look, I think beautiful people on both sides of the divide, Australia and the South. Yeah, definitely.
Well, we just want to tell you how much we love everybody in Pseudo Echo.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
It's insanity. We love so
we
much.
Do love
down
each
to earth.
Other.
Yeah. We had a wonderful conversation starting out with Brian and everybody and Raquel. And it was just really like we just, it's almost like we knew each other our whole lives.
Yeah.
It was crazy.
Yeah.
Very similar life situations and just everything about it. You know, and then your crew, I mean, Scott, everybody in the whole, we just feel at home with you.
Well, so, I was just saying to Jay before that we got stuck together because you came on after us and we had the tents nearby and you're like, come into our tent. And I'm like, all right, no worries. Yeah. I'm one of those chicks that'll go and play with anyone, you know.
Yes.
And Muddy was turning around to me going, are you right going into their tent? I'm like, they asked us. And so there was an instant connection with the two bands, 100%.
Oh, yeah.
And a similar vibe with, you know, when you're in a band and you kind of go, how am I here? And then you look back at your life and you have crossed paths for over 25 years. It was the same with Brian and I. Yeah. I was hanging out with the band at 18, the original Pseudo Echo lineup, and going to like music shows with them, and they were showing me the ropes to the industry.
Oh, wow.
And I sort of didn't have much to do with Brian. And then 10 years after that, or 15 years after that, I was still hanging out with them. Then Maddie joined Pseudo Echo. So because we date, I was back in Pseudo Echo sort of again. And then eventually I ended up joining 8 years from there. So it was just a surreal situation.
That's absolutely awesome. And everyone is so cool. When you came in, Brian and I just was tripped out. I'm like, how down to earth is this gentleman? Like this is.
He is.
So amazing. We're talking about life, talking about how we met, you know, partners and my wife. And it was similar.
Yeah, right.
I met my wife 19 years after knowing her in high school.
Yeah, right.
With another marriage in there. And it was just, I couldn't believe how down to earth. And we're talking business and about how bands work and the band I have now that's original, but it's more of a, you know, I guess you call them the, what do you call those things?
Tribute band.
Thank you, Chan. Yeah. That's the word of all the 80s stuff because I loved it so much. But anyway, the whole band is awesome. And then Abby's over there just whipping ass.
Oh, look, and, that's it. Abby's everybody. Become the highlight, hasn't
no,
she?
No, she's amazing.
She's just insane. Yes. Drummer.
Oh, yeah, and human.
And I was just saying, you're like, she's 20 years of age. And you wouldn't have noticed, but the last gig we did, one of the tracks sort of went a bit haywire and she fixed it. 20-year-old fixed it on the spot and we were like, wow. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean?
And with a big smile on her face
with
the whole
time. With a big smile on her face, that's right. She cried after her first solo at the gig she did in Taupo.
That's the one that was on, that's on Instagram.
She was overwhelmed by it all that she just started streaming with tears, which makes you want to love her even more, you know?
Well, there was a huge crowd there.
Huge.
Huge crowd, like a sea of people.
15,000, 20,000,
so
I
she's
think.
Up there just doing her thing.
I know.
And just as natural as she could be.
That's right.
Unbelievable. Unbelievable. Great tour. All the female drummers on this tour. Can you believe how great they are?
I mean. Kicking my ass.
I love them. I'm a huge fan. Huge fan.
Hey, love Johnny. It. Can I just quiz you for a moment, mate? My good friend James Mudd from Pseudo has told us that you have an 80s band in your spare time. Is that right?
Totally right. And it's not really an original name, but we're happy about it. It's NU80, almost like UB40.
NU80.
So NU and then 80. And it's, you know, look, right now we don't have a ton of followers for our original stuff. But if you go to... either Apple Music or Spotify, we're on there with we did a record during the pandemic and we called it Vaccine, being like, it's going to be the cure for everybody, our music. So it's a musical vaccine.
Oh, so it's an original 80s.
It is. I'm pretty proud of it.
Wow.
We recorded it in my studio. It's called Fungin Studio. It's a fun dungeon.
Fungin.
And and then we had Bob St. John, who did a lot of Extremes recordings and production, do the vocal recording and also the mixing and mastering. So it really had, we wanted to get original music that had the 80s sound, but it was our originals. And Paul Souza, the vocalist, was in a band, Beat Surrender, years ago out of Boston. And it was a pretty big deal. And they had a little MTV video. And and like a lot of things, and I don't think Paul would be upset by this, just the industry went weird and it didn't get released properly. But he plays me his demos from that shit. And it's like, he's like, oh, yeah, here's some of my stuff. And I'm like, this is fucking amazing.
Oh, wow.
It just didn't get what it needed to get. Anyway, so he's the singer. And we have Nate Gray on bass and then Joseph Harrison on guitar. We did it at the house and there's 5 songs. So if you go to NU80 artist and look, I would love to get people's feedback. And Instagram is, we need to do a better job on Instagram, but we're at NU80 band. So I love the band. And we also do about a 90-minute full production show that is with a video backdrop of of the 80s stuff that we love.
Great.
Fantastic. And what kind of stuff do you like?
This band is focused on the synth-driven pop music of the 80s. So it's everybody
Brilliant.
From – yeah, it's all Simple Minds to – what do we got in there? We got Bowie to – we even do – what do we got here? We do some Duran Duran. I'm trying to, and I'm sorry, I'm a little bit drawing blanks here, but we've got everything you can imagine from that synth, you know, sequence synth driven stuff. I mean, and we've, we do Kaja Gugu. It's in there. Yeah.
And then do you do any kind of, what about that song Pocket Calculator that you love so much?
Oh, do you love Pocket Calculator?
Well, I mean, one of the biggest Kraftwerk fans.
Are you really?
On the planet. Yep.
We had a whole show dedicated to pocket calculators and stuff that you have on your mobile that you used to need all these other things for, like a pocket calculator and a whatever.
Your old
diary
watch.
And Rolodex and all that stuff. And people love that show because it's all on your phone now.
You can make a record pretty much.
So you're a huge Kraftwerk.
Roger.
You could make a record.
Yeah. I'm a huge Kraftwerk fan.
Wow.
I was growing up in California, real quick, I thought that they looked like Devo, and no one told me
they were the different band.
Yeah, or no one told me to go what to buy.
Yeah, right.
There was no one going like, you need to go get Funkadelic, whatever. So I'd go to Tower Records, and anything that had funk in the name, mm-hmm. I would buy. Mm-hmm. Then I saw this Kraftwerk. I'm like, these dudes, I already love Devo, huge Devo fan. So I was like, these guys look like a little more strict or whatever Devo.
Yeah, right.
And when I heard some of the stuff at first, I was like, it freaked me out a little bit. Like literally at night, I couldn't listen to some of the shit. Because I'm like, who does this?
Oh, it takes your mind on a journey.
Oh, it's
very
like,
challenging.
When you listen to the model, are you kidding me? You're a supermodel, man.
The model is the trippiest song.
It's just the best.
Dude, Showroom Dummies?
I love it.
Think about this real quick, that somebody went, it's a showroom dummy. That's a lyric, and that's how he sang. And
truth. That's right.
And the fucking dummies break out.
And Johnny Rab loves it.
I love it. They break out at night through the glass. Right. They break out through the glass.
Scares the shit out of me.
It didn't. You know what scared the shit out of me the most, guys?
What?
One of the damn insides of the records. I forgot which one. If it was Computer World or something. These dipshits. They've got their whole faces are cut off. Heads are cut off.
Oh shit!
And it's all 3D.
Right.
Like this whole mannequin. Like you're not seeing my face, but. Scared the shit out of me. Yeah, I was in seventh grade.
Yeah.
It's part of my mouth, guys.
Yeah, right.
Not at all.
Scared me, guys.
Oh, no, don't worry. We're usually worse. We're being good today. Okay.
ADD.
So do you do any craft work in your 80s band, or you just don't go as hard as that?
We don't. I do a solo drum show that
Screaming in Glass.
No, I just remix. I remix Ableton, craft work and stuff like that. And
wow.
Tempo shift to drum and bass or house, but doing craft work. I'll pitch shift a pocket calculator so no one knows what it is for like 30 minutes.
Right.
And then I'll take the pitch shift down.
Right.
And it's funny to see the one person in the audience literally go, that's craft work.
Yeah.
He's been doing craft work this whole time.
100%.
Yeah. Anyway.
It's exciting to get that one person though. Do you have a drink with them and get to know them and go, man, we're fucking, you know. Should be brothers.
Back in the day. Now I'm like all packing the minivan and, you know.
Yeah.
Getting home.
Jeez.
I'm kidding.
Because, I mean, Collective Soul, I was speaking to someone, it might have been Cheney, 70 gigs a year you do?
Yeah, right. Between 70 and 80.
So where do you find time to do the other stuff?
Like?
The cover bands and
if you're touring 80 days a year, you're probably gone about 140 to 160 days a year total. So you have a half year, essentially 200 dates to do a lot of things.
That's good.
Now we've been the past 4 years, we've been recording every January.
That's a good rule.
It really is. And it works out perfect because, you know, Ed bought a real cool rig and we just take it places. And we've taken it all over the place. We've taken it down to Tybee Island in Georgia. We've taken it to Palm Springs at Elvis Presley's home, which is where we just did the double album.
Wow.
Right.
Oh, wow.
So it's a pretty big deal. We're really proud of it. It's, 30-year anniversary for Collective Soul.
Wow.
Now, you know, I'm very fortunate to get to still be a part of some of these recordings. You know, they let me play, they let me do some percussion and I'll do some background vocals and, you know, a couple of tracks on drums. But, you know, the big part about it is me helping set it up and tear it down because I kind of helped build the rig with my buddy Sean Grove, our producer guy Sean Grove.
Mm.
And so we've been doing that every year for the past, at least 4 years. So we still have 3 or 4 records in the hopper that are not even mixed yet. Yeah, so it's going to be.
Is that right?
So yeah, man.
It's just living music.
It is.
100% of the time.
It is.
Now, I've really watched you guys because Aussies are a little bit, we love to think that we are hard workers, but we're not the biggest dreamers in the world.
Okay.
It does, like you guys just go for this whole thing. As kids, you know, we're sort of taught as kids, you can't do that. You'll never be that. I can feel the difference between the two bands.
Okay.
I feel like in Australia, we sort of got to have a day job and then go out and do music. Was that ever anything you needed to do?
Absolutely.
Right.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Especially being a hired musician.
Yeah.
You know, that didn't write the songs.
Yeah, right.
So that's a huge part about it. So, yeah. I mean, ever since I was 18 years old, I've worked at a music store in sales. Yes. I mean, I always went back to it because I could do it well.
Yeah.
And or drum, you know, drum instruction for kids, you know, mm-hmm. And mm-hmm. intermediate. And then I would also do studio mixing, producing, nothing on a major scale, but I would, you know, be able to work.
Yeah.
You know, so if you have all that stuff that you can do, and I bought and sold gear, I did the whole eBay thing. I'd go to Nashville from Atlanta and purchase gear at pawn shops or wherever I could find gear and then flip it.
Right.
I mean, I would do whatever I could to make money for my family.
Yeah.
You know, so as a drummer, especially, everybody understands this as a side musician, if you will, if you want to call it that. I mean, everybody makes you feel a part of your group, but you're still a side musician.
Mm.
It doesn't hurt to have plan B, plan C, plan D.
Yeah.
It doesn't hurt.
But the thing is, you've done music in that, though.
Everything's been.
The
I know. Yeah, you're
you know
right
what
about
I mean?
That. You're right.
And that's the thing I'm trying to say is I've got a lot of people, because I've done music now for 35, 40 years.
Mm-hmm.
And I just don't want to do anything else. Jay is a teacher and stuff like that. And we used to be teachers at a music school. Always great.
I believe it.
But I reckon Australians are a little bit more on the fear side with actually getting there and just like, because I know that Jim Kerr spoke to Brian yesterday about his music. They've been listening to Pseudo for 2 days. Mm. And Brian was just blown away by that. Now, really, he shouldn't be.
No.
Because he's Brian Canham from Pseudo Echo. But that's what I'm saying. There's part of us in Australia that is a little bit shy and timid to actually acknowledge the fact that we are this epic fucking thing that's done this thing where you guys know it. You know what I mean? Yes.
Absolutely.
But I know Australia, it sounds bizarre, but
Australia is a very sort of working class nation.
It's very working class.
It's considered a luxury to be an artist, you know.
That's right.
You're barely given any encouragement. And it was really actually obvious during the pandemic when everything got shut down and there was no support for musos or artists because, you know, basically our jobs are seasonal. You know, we're sort of contractors or subcontractors, and our jobs are seasonal. You know, we have sort of massive periods where we're very busy, and then periods where we're, you know, just chilling out and finding our inspiration. And the artists in Australia, it really spoke very loudly when the artists in Australia didn't get support from the federal government. You know, lots of other industries did, but not the artists. But then, of course, when everything sort of opens up again, who do they turn to for all of their sort of benefit concerts and their fundraisers? And you know, it's really, really interesting that contradiction.
Yes. Oh, I totally agree. We had the similar thing, but I want to speak on behalf of what it looks like for the United States, at least on my opinion of Australian artists. Huge influence. We didn't know. There's not a thought of what you were just talking about, the non-dreaming. Mm. Like I wanted to be in all the bands that you guys had. You know what I mean?
Right.
Whether it's New Zealand or Australia, from Midnight Oil to, I mean, I'm like, wait, in excess to, you know, Pseudo Echo, and I'm saying that for real, like watching the video at my house when I'm, I think I'm 10 years younger than Brian.
Yeah.
So you can imagine as a kid, Brian would have seemed like, I'm like, who's that older guy? But now that's nothing. Age is nothing.
No, that's
you know what
right.
I mean? You know what I mean? When you start to meet people when you're an adult, that's what I'm trying to say. It's age is nothing.
It's really like interesting because I'm battling with that as a woman.
Yeah.
It's like, oh my God, I shouldn't be doing this at this age. You know, it's almost like you beat yourself down and I had a meltdown yesterday going, what the fuck is wrong with me? This should be just like the biggest thing ever. But then you think, oh my God, I'm just doing this now at this age, which is 50.
We're the same age.
Exactly. Yeah. I'm 53, but I say 50.
I'm 52.
Yeah.
So there we go.
Am I 53? Yeah. Anyway, it's really, I find it really mentally taxing
Ask
on
Cheney.
People's mental health, man. Like yes. it's, and the boys were freaking out before we came here, and I'm like, "What are you talking about? It's going to be great." And then I sort of fell down yesterday and went, "Yeah, I'm not feeling like I deserve this, and I feel like I'm leaving everyone behind, and they're not seeing this amazing scenery, you know."
Yeah.
But how much space are you going to give yourself to actually say you fucking deserve it, you know?
That's what you just said is what should happen.
That's right.
I've talked to Cheney almost every day going, I got to get out of the room because I'm starting to do that thing of the same thing. What am I – how am I here?
Yeah.
How are we all here?
Yeah.
And then those crowds, what I mean by this, do help your psychological, but then when you're off
That's
from that,
right.
you start to be like, how did that just happen?
Exactly.
How did we get to – you know, and then shaking Jim Kerr's hand yeah. in the parking lot, but trying not to be like – you pretty much transformed a lot of my 80s, buddy.
Yeah.
You want to say that, yeah. but you don't. You
know? I went today with two bags of rice that I wanted microwaved and a can of tuna that had a hook to open it. And in front of Jim Kerr at the fucking reception, I said, do you have a can opener for this? And Jim went, there's a hook, you can open it with your hand. And I went, no! I just look like a blonde in front of Jim Kerr.
That stuff, isn't it weird? I did this too. I don't know if anyone else did, but one of the most epic scenes of the video is, I don't know if they filmed it in Scotland. I don't know where they did it, but the Alive and Kicking video.
On the mountains?
Yes.
Yeah.
And that camera work
that.
Of like going through the shit, like
yes.
early drones, but it was no drone. It's probably some dude being all, God, I'm going backwards.
That's right. There were no drones. That's right.
And that keyboard dude. Remember that he'd be
yes.
like all looking at you when
yeah.
he saw the breakdown?
Yeah.
That whole band that made me want to
yes
play that. There was no country associated with it. Does that make sense?
Absolutely.
It was
yeah.
Simple
there
Minds.
There was no country.
No. I know. And so to see them being like, I'm in a parking lot, I'm getting on an airplane. I'm like,
yeah.
dude.
He was in his hotel slippers in the fucking
it's great.
Front of the bloody hotel today. Jim Kerr in his little slippers. And I was like, there's Jimbo, you know. And it is, though, it's funny because when you're a kid, you dream of being that big and then you get there and you go, I don't know whether I deserve this. My parents aren't here with me. I feel bad that they're missing out on this. I'm going through all that stuff.
Yeah, I understand.
So that's a normal start, a normal thing.
I think so. You just said that breakdown thing. Literally, you can ask Cheney my up and downs of, I just don't know.
Yeah, right.
Or
yeah.
Like when I get home, am I going to, you know, with my family, it's like, because like I'm doing yard work.
Yeah,
and
right.
I want to be.
Yeah.
But then I'm going, all my high school friends are shitting themselves because of this tour lineup.
Yeah,
they're
totally.
Like, what?
Same with our kids, our people.
Yeah, totally.
Well, yeah. I mean, but the one thing we all have to realize, though, is that we've all worked hard and we're all worthy of what's happening right now.
Mm.
Absolutely. Everybody's earned it.
Yeah.
From top to bottom. From Simple Minds to, I mean, those guys, I can't imagine, those guys rehearsed for 2 weeks.
That's right.
Before we even got there.
Yeah, that's right.
Have they earned it? Absolutely.
Yeah, that's right.
Absolutely.
Good point.
There's some hard workers on this tour.
So you got to keep this in mind too. We've all probably started when we probably thought about this stuff when we were even 10 years old.
Yeah.
Like this is probably what I want to do or something. Like that, you know, I want to do something in music or I want to do whatever. I didn't get into Collective Soul until I was 35 years old.
Right.
Wow.
So.
Which is old. People say that's old, don't they, all the time to you?
Yes, yes. So anybody at any age can do anything.
Mm.
I look at Morgan Freeman as an actor.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, yeah. Really, he did. I mean, you got to look at that. I mean, it doesn't really matter as long as you have what the group needs at the time.
Yeah.
It doesn't matter how old you are. And everybody needs to understand that you're worthy of this blessing that you're given.
Mm.
Okay. Everybody's worthy of it. Even if you're the worst singer in the world or not, like yourself.
Thank you.
Or, you know, it doesn't matter. If you're there and it's happening, it's supposed to be happening at that moment. So,
is it something you slowly develop as you get along, getting used to that?
As far sick, what do you mean by that?
Well, like every time you go out with different artists,
oh, yeah.
does it feel easier?
It feels It depends on the artist.
Yeah,
for
right.
me, for me, I mean, like to give an example, you know, we were talking about 80s stuff, so. You know, Rab has done a great deal of stuff with the more pop, you know, well, the stuff I love the most, really, in the 80s. I actually was more involved with more of the rock and roll
yeah.
Part. Like, I played with members of Cinderella, if you remember that band.
Oh, my God. Yeah. Wow.
I played with members from Motley Crue, which is John Corabi. I don't know if you know that
yeah,
guy.
Yeah, I noticed that online. That's very impressive.
Credit. There's some really cool things. I was more into the rock. You know, my first
yep.
big rock show was Ozzy Osbourne when I was 13.
Yeah,
so I was
wow.
I loved the rock and roll. But then I also loved the pop aspect of the 70s and stuff. My first concert as a baby was Olivia Newton-John.
Oh, my God. Amazing.
You know, so I grew up on all that. But, you know, to get back to, you know, playing with 80s artists and all that type of stuff, those guys are still going through, because you got to realize when you go up
yeah.
the ladder like they did.
Yeah.
And then now you're way down the ladder.
Mm.
It's a little bit, it's tough.
Yeah,
it
that's
really,
right.
It really is tough for the rock and roll 80s guys. And I noticed that right off in getting to perform with them. And that was right after Collective Soul. You know, I played with some of those guys. And I decided to, you know, that it really probably wasn't for me because they weren't. They kind of got into that thing that you were just talking about, like that whole not worthy kind of
yeah.
not kind of like, you know, almost depressed that they're not as doing it as yeah. big as they were. And that was tough for me because I tried to be real positive and it was really tough for me to have to be around that. And as much as I love and still love all of those people that I played with and believe me, more than honored to get to share the stage with all of them.
Yeah, that's right.
I really feel like the positivity is not where I would want it to be, if that makes any sense.
Right.
I don't want to interrupt Cheney, but like I know I got the mouth that like can cuss and all that, but all the jokes aside,
yeah.
You're very eloquent about mm-hmm. what you're saying, Cheney, because I got an opportunity to work with a lot of the 80s hair metal, hair whatever, right? Ricky Rocket from Poison, we're both, we all know, made a signature stick for him. I was fortunate enough to have a stick company. And that's not my point here. My point is when I was doing that, I wanted to be on stage playing, not making drumsticks.
Sure.
So I was like, oh no, I'm not going to be able to do this. My goal of being in the cars or being, you know what I mean? Like I
in
tour with,
yeah.
you know what I mean? Yeah. Like, so, in getting to meet those people, I know what Cheney means because even on some of these festivals, and this is not anything wrong, but the eras change, right?
Yeah.
So now the 80s to me is kind of cycling back and we're seeing Psychedelic Furs going on tour and coming to the US and doing theaters. We're seeing, what I'm saying is even if the name kind of went away for a little bit, everyone still loves OMD. You put on... You know,
if you leave.
Thank you. That's exactly.
Yeah, I'm with you.
And then people freaking out about if the Thompson twins somehow, and one of our friends runs lights, and I'm like, I was like a kid
yeah.
to her going, you what? How cool is the guy?
Yeah.
How cool is like, do they do this? Oh yeah, they do all
yeah.
that. I'm stuck in that. And some of these dreams get probably broken when a promoter or when the crowd goes, I used to like, I'm not even going to name a band, but I used to love going to these shows, but now it's more, the theaters have lessened to maybe now a club or like for some yeah. of these bands or a festival might be a slot. We've had a few times where I've seen some upset folks being like, why is Collective Soul higher? And I don't mean that like we're some neat
oh,
thing.
Oh yeah, that kind of just.
That happens sometimes. That kind of, and I get Cheney's thing of like the getting negative or, and I've seen some good friends that were drummers that, you know, that are not as active and it's hurt their hearts, I think, yeah. you know, and I love them from some of the 80s, you know, so there's no guarantee, right? That's what I guess
that's
another
right.
thing.
That's You're, right.
Lastly, Cheney is, you guys are all right on the doing this and should be happy about it and living in the moment, no matter
yeah.
what level it is. Cause I remember learning that I'm like, oh, Neil Peart from Rush wait a second. I was like in second grade. And I went, you can do that for a living? And I was walking on the sidewalk to school and I went, that's what I'm doing. I want to try it. And I didn't, there's all those barriers, right? There was no internet back then. No internet. So you you're trying to send fan mail that's like rejected.
Yeah.
You know, I got rejected. I got rejected fan mail at age 12 from from sending Wang Chung. Hey, if you need a drummer.
Oh, you're heaven.
I was 12. And then also the outfield. I'm like, hey guys, I love you guys. And I know I'm 13, but if your guy quits, send me a letter back.
Oh my God. That's so awesome.
I have to admit something. I did the same thing.
Really?
Absolutely. It was Pearl Jam though.
Yep. Oh wow.
I did.
Oh,
I sent Brendan O'Brien, the producer, a letter. Same thing. Great. It's just but you know what that is? That's being assertive.
Yep.
And that's trying to put your stamp on what you do. Yeah. There's nothing wrong with that at all. People should admire that.
Isn't it amazing, like the different approaches to music when you're at different ages? And I mean, you guys have been talking about, you know, working hard and your legacy and where you are at a particular age and all that kind of thing. I think sort of being a musician of a more mature age, I don't think musicians are a sort of a mature breed. You know, if you know a few musicians, but if you are of a particular age and you've sort of kept everything running, like you haven't sort of retired and then come back, you know, all the wheels are turning, you're well oiled, you're doing your thing, you're out there. It keeps your soul young. Like you are still in touch with that sort of force of youth that runs through all of us, and very much so for musos. And you also become almost like a more open channel for the music, because a lot of your youthful ego sort of falls away and stops getting in the way. And you just sort of serve the music a little bit better, I feel. I'm really compelled by musicians that are, you know, in their 40s and 50s and 60s and 70s and who knows, beyond sometimes, who are still out there kicking it. I just think it's the most incredible thing to watch those guys doing their thing.
Oh, my God, like the Rolling Stones blow my mind every time I see a clip from them on a social media platform or something. I mean – those guys are 80.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah.
And they're up there killing it.
Yes. Yeah, yes. Yeah.
Oh, my gosh.
Yeah, it's phenomenal.
I'm glad that we all think the same on this type of stuff.
And they've got to get on the same planes. They've got to do the same hours of travel, sit in the same hours of hotel rooms on their own. And that's the hardest part, I think. I think the stage part is really easy. It's just traveling and time, and you know what I mean?
Yes, I do. and I don't mean that in a bad way. I mean it in an unexpected way that before the Collective Soul journey of being able to play gigs in 2012, I think both Cheney and I would agree, we ran across paths more in the drummer's drumming industry.
Right.
Clinics and weird, like, hey, here's this flashy thing. And I got very pigeonholed as this type of thing. Mm. And I was very worried that I would never be able to have a band.
Oh, no.
That was not looked at as like either a flashy band or. So I'm going to be serious, like, knowing every single drummer except for Shane well. I do know Shane now, right? But you and Ryan, I knew. And it was so funny. I'm like, I love these guys. And people, like I said earlier, not trying to rehash it, but people would, oh, you must not like it. It's not like that. We're sending each other music ideas. Yeah. We're hearing you love Wang Chung, you love Outfield, you love, you know, all these bands. And I think the neatest thing is, remember I said that thing earlier about the age not mattering? We all were talking about that.
Yeah.
I remember ice skating, which is I'm terrible at, but I ice skated in high school and we built this city, was on the stupid PA.
Yeah.
And I'm like, yeah, you know, ice skating around. And I had my girlfriend at the time and I'm sitting there going, no offense to my girlfriend, but I'm like, I'm so into this production and to the drumming. And I'm sure she's like, oh, baby, oh, day, day. She doesn't sound like that, but I think you
guys. She sounds like me.
Well, you get my point.
I'm not a huge fan of the song.
Oh, it's okay. But check this out. I got really into the drummer, Donnie Baldwin,
right,
and his programming and his electronic. I was like, how the hell is he doing that? And to be able to meet Mickey Thomas in person and have him come out and watch him sing right in front of us, like closer than we are, and do in the round vocals, me, Cheney, and the guys. And no matter where that ended up, I got to do that. And I'm like, how the hell am I with the dude that I like pretty much like pop idolized, thinking the band, they would never be able to play that live. I'm like, they were such on a pedestal. And then to be able to, now that the internet exists, I get it. Thank you. I know it's been around for years now. I'm like, it just got invented.
Just last week.
Yeah. I just tuned in. but to see live old footage has been my favorite thing. And if I'm kind of glad it didn't exist when I was a kid, because I don't know what I would have.
You may not have had the brave to sort of go there.
I just,
it might
maybe
have
that
scared you, you know.
It just, there was not the mystery.
Yeah.
I love the mystery. Now you can type in, and I suggest everyone does this. You know, Wang Chung live at the Ritz.
Wow.
And just get ready to get nuts.
Wow, really?
Yeah.
You're amazing. Everyone have fun tonight. Everyone Johnny Rab tonight.
Do it. Do it. Everyone,
right.
Johnny Rabbit.
Fucking rock on, Johnny. I'm learning more about this band than I ever have in this interview. You are fucking nut jobs.
I am.
I love it.
Cheney's not.
No.
Well,
I'm
no,
not.
It's. I think you might both be. But that's what you've got to be. You know, you have to be a little bit playful. I've had to. Like, I was like standing next to Jim Kerr with a fucking can of tuna. I had to do something. And, yeah, like, what the fuck was that?
It doesn't matter.
If you had said that to me, like, you know, 30 years ago, because I saw the same video clip on the mountain. Robin, I was speaking to the two girls in Simple Minds about that video, because I think the new backing vocals, she's not new anymore, she's been with him for 16 years or something.
Sarah?
She sounds like Robin. Sarah, yeah, sounds like Robin. I said, you know, I think your timbre in your voice is exactly like Robin when she did the big. And she goes, oh, my God, the video clip in the mountains. That's always the one everyone remembers. It's not Don't You Forget About Me for me.
No,
it's the video clip in the mountains, and it's also Somewhere in Summertime and the early, like, that was just art, wasn't it?
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yes. Big fan. Crazy.
Crazy fan.
Nutty fan.
Nutty fan. And the thing is, it's, you've like really got to, you know, because Jim still looks at you like he's.
I saw that.
A cat, you know.
I saw that happen.
Yeah.
And I'm like,
he
that's.
He loves the bend over too.
And that's him.
Yeah.
I was like, man, he's almost doing the splits. This is
that's
insane.
That's right.
Right?
And fucking hell. You just don't know what to look at, do you?
I just, he commanded that crowd.
He did.
The band commanded the crowd.
Yeah.
All the musicians in it are great. Cherise sounds amazing.
Cherise, amazing.
And I don't know.
Charlie was ripping up there too, man.
Charlie, as a guitarist, is fucking incredible.
Solid as a rock. Yeah. Solid as a rock.
You know?
Amazing.
How are you with the accent? Can you understand it?
With who? What do you mean? As far
the
as Charlie?
Scottish.
Oh, with Charlie?
With everyone.
Absolutely.
Really? It must be hard for Aussies.
Well, I mean, do you have to focus in? Yes.
I think he said something about a singer today and I totally missed it. But then when I walked away, I went, there was like a 10-second delay. Like, did he say singer? Did I just miss an opportunity? You know
oh,
what I mean?
No.
I know, right?
Well, you know.
It's not my fault.
No.
And when the universe will bring that back again somehow.
It will.
Yeah.
Jim, when I first got to the hotel in Taupo, Jim was staying in the same little building that I was. So I was going out and he was coming in. And, of course, I'm trying to remain calm because they were a huge
influence
thing for me. Huge. I mean, I remember just listening to the Don't You Forget About Me song time after time and just trying to learn the drum lick and trying to just groove with what, you know, that whole, that, I mean, it was a huge part of my trying to get tight as drummer.
And not only that, The Breakfast Club was such an intellectual movie.
Oh yeah.
And a spiritually moving movie that song was connected to that.
Unbelievable.
So it's even bigger again, you know.
Absolutely.
You're exactly right. Yeah, the marriage of that film, yeah, the marriage of the film and that song, just that sort of formed the icon status of both, you know. They pushed each other right up there, didn't they?
This is going to sound weird, but this is not a fake story. This is a real story that happened to me, and I couldn't believe it, and no one else cared in my school, and I have a picture.
Awesome.
I have a picture to prove it, so it's not bullshit.
Yep.
The movie comes out.
Mm-hmm.
That whole era is movies. I lived in Sacramento, California, which is about 6 hours from L.A.
Yeah.
So to me, those movies, like Fast Times at Ridgemont High, were real. It wasn't. I had friends from other places going, does anyone actually act like that? I'm like, my entire school.
It's a documentary.
It really was almost like us with an old video recorder going around. I'm like, Spicoli is my friend Justin. Okay, cool. So when the whole detention thing happened, right, with like Breakfast Club and all that, I was just tripping. I'm like, that was like our detentions. But here's the real story. So imagine the song coming out, killing it. Imagine the drum fill and things the Cheney's talking about. Then imagine all that influence of like, okay, I love the band. I love the movie. Even I thought it was weird that Pretty in Pink, is that Psychedelic Furs? Weird song.
Pink.
It's just called Pretty in
Pink.
That
was Pretty in Pink. That was another movie.
I know, but wait. The other song.
There was a song there.
Perfect. So Psych Furs, I think, did Pretty in Pink, and I thought it was the weirdest chord changes ever.
Yeah.
I was like, what a weird voice. Yeah. I won't even go on. So the 80s movies, that's what I mean by Pretty in Pink. All these movies that were in that, the same actors and stuff, right?
Yeah.
So Breakfast Club comes out. And I'm not kidding. I'm over at my friend Mike John's house, walkable in California, same vibe, skateboarded over, get in, and I'm shit you not, we're in seventh grade, and my friend Mike's brother, they were having, I don't know why they're doing this, who has kindergarten reunions, but they're having a kindergarten reunion for some reason.
Wow.
No one gave a shit, but Mrs. John's goes, she kind of sounded Kermit the Froggy. She goes, hey, everyone, I don't want anyone to be weird, but Molly Ringwald's coming over.
And I'm like, oh, what? Fuck off.
And I go,
you would have.
I go, what? What? And remember, there's not cell phones. I'm like, Mrs. Johns.
There's no cell phones. That's right.
Mrs. Johns, is there any way? And Molly was ready to leave. And I'm like, Molly, I had a crush on her. I'm like,
yeah.
I'm like, is there any way I can get a photo? And Mrs. Johns took the sweet Polaroid.
Wow.
And I tell you, my childhood with that crap, like actually meeting, not her later, literally months after shit was breaking into theaters.
Yeah. Like when she's smoking hot and just so
what?
Cool.
What?
I've seen the photo.
Yeah.
I believe you.
And I'm sorry if that just wasted a ton of digital airspace.
No, that's awesome.
Our people love to hear. This is the stuff.
That one got me though, guys. I was, and everyone's making fun of me, except for my own age of people in my little junior high when I brought the Polaroid to school. I was whipping ass.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, my
yeah.
God.
Yeah. Yeah.
And she was nice.
Oh, yeah, no, she is. I've heard her on podcasts. She sounds lovely.
Yeah.
Very family-orientated girl.
Anyway, that has nothing to do with anything except for music and movie, Simple Minds in the 80s. So, God dang it, good memories.
No, you're doing well at this show because we do tangent off really interesting stories.
Oh, fuck yeah, we go right off.
We know everything. We just and have these fantastic stories that as kids and that have developed you and you and your passion, you know.
Yeah.
And what's even cooler is we're across the world from one another.
That's right.
That's what I love.
It's absolutely brilliant.
Yeah.
You know, like sometimes sort of technology can really, really piss you off, and you wonder sort of, you know, is this world better because of all the technology that we are integrated with? And then other times you can do things like this, which are just a miracle, really.
Absolutely.
So I thought we might play a bit of Simple Minds just to break up the energy and give everyone a taste of this song, which is a ripper, Simple Minds. ¶¶ you're listening to the 80s Montage. That was Simple Minds. And how excited are we to have these two beautiful boys in the studio tonight, in the hotel room in New Zealand?
It is a studio because it can be anywhere these days, folks.
That's right. Yeah, that's right. It can be.
And thank you for calling us beautiful.
Yeah. Oh, you are, though.
Well.
Really cool. Really cool.
As you.
Oh, it's just been such an amazing experience, hasn't it?
Yes.
Now, I want to know when Collective Soul, let's get back on track. I want to know when Collective Soul are coming to Melbourne.
We are going to at some point. We tried to. There was a little bit of a conflict. If I don't want to speak out of line here, Cheney's obviously a tour manager. But wasn't there a conflict of something we already agreed to?
I don't believe there was any kind of conflict other than the fact that we didn't have enough time to get it locked in. Okay. That's all it was. It's just, and you know, what's beautiful is hopefully 2025 or 2026 we can make a multi show.
Yeah.
Yes. Yeah. Like get over to Australia.
That's brilliant. Mm-hmm. That's great to hear. I've got to say, look, Mel, I do know that it's a big trek coming across to Australia. We are so far away from everything. I know it is a big trek for musos to come and visit us. But look, we would be incredibly appreciative if you were to come to Australia. And Melbourne really is such a great base to start your tour. It's Melbourne is very much the home of live music in Australia, and I know you guys would just be incredible here, and the crowds would just love it.
Absolutely. Well, the thing is, man, you know, we wanted to go really bad, and we tried, we tried, and I do think we can make it happen for sure.
Fantastic. I mean, good to hear. Yeah.
We would love that.
That's brilliant. Now, I'm very mindful that you gentlemen have been talking to us for over like 45 minutes now, and I'm sure you want to sort of break off and have a drink and do your thing. Am I right?
I mean, we're pumped to talk to you, so keep going till 6 a.m. or whatever.
Yeah. This is amazing. This is amazing.
Run out of database.
It's absolutely brilliant, guys.
Thank
we
you.
Really appreciate your time. It's been huge just to chat with you. What I love most of all is just how musicians are just the same breed. It's like we're from the same family, or, you know, there's that familiarity straight away, and you meet your people regardless of where they're from in the world, and there's just that beautiful warm feeling of familiarity. So thank you very much for coming on the show and chatting to us tonight, Johnny and Cheney. Thank you very much.
Thank you, buddy.
Yeah, thank you so much. And don't forget, as you said, the journey is far. It's not just on you guys, it's also on us. The journey to the States is far, but we want to see Pseudo Echo and the bands from Australia over in the States.
Yeah.
We really want to see that. And so thank you for, you know, I had a chance to go tour Australia with Roland Corporation for years, but this has been an exciting thing doing it in a band. So thanks for having us on the show as well, guys.
Yeah, look, it's been brilliant. Amazing.
Yeah, you guys have been wonderful to us, and we can't thank you enough.
Yeah.
Seriously.
Oh, that's brilliant. Thank you very much.
Just the industry, and talking about the industry like this is really rare to find on a podcast. Mental health and stuff like that, there's no egos involved, and you're just telling it how it is, you know. And I think it's really important for musos when they do get to this level to understand that it's not easy, and it's something that is also very rewarding. You know, which is awesome.
That's right. It's like we say, Sammy, it's not all tits and
it's not
feathers.
Not all tits
is it?
And feathers, that's right.
I like that idea.
Yeah. No? If only it was, boys. If only it was.
Oh, that's hilarious.
Absolutely brilliant.
You guys.
Thank you, Johnny and Cheney from Collective
Thank
Soul.
You very much.
Just fantastic.
Thank you, buddy. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
A big shout out to all our listeners all around the world, especially those Collective Soul bands, fans. Guys, big shout out to our subscribers and also our Patreons. You can become a Patreon for as little as $1.50 a month. It's not much. And then you become part of this little club and you get the extra episodes. So it's absolutely brilliant. So thank you to our existing Patreons. Become a subscriber, guys. It's the easiest thing you can do. Just click subscribe rather than listen to the one odd episode. Become a subscriber and jump on board for as long as you can. And please like, share, rate, and review. Write us a little message in the review section. It really pushes us up the charts and gets the message out there.
Absolutely, especially on iTunes and Spotify. If you'd like to become a Patreon, it's patreon.com/the80s montage podcast. And anything on Rewind 80s Band, rewind80sband.com. We've got a heap of gigs coming up in March while Pseudo's on holidays. And you can come along and get your tickets and have a great night.
Really looking forward to seeing you all, guys, and we will see you next week. I hope you've enjoyed it. We've absolutely loved it. And if it's music, mateys,
or cool shit from the 80s,
we're going to talk about it.
Unreal.